the inauguration day. That's, is that right word? I grew up in America, so I did these things wrong. I waited many, many years to become a citizen of the United States. Basically, because I don't know. In principle, I think you should have as many passports as possible. But in practice, I like to avoid the kind of people who give out passports. I noticed somebody here today was here this week was saying, "Well, I'm not a citizen because you know." I said, "Oh, I used to feel that way too," and I became a citizen in a ceremony in a big Art Deco hall in Oakland, full of with 1,000 people from 100 countries. And afterwards, with a photo of me looking slightly manic, wearing a Prada suit with a cutout of Barack and Michelle Obama, registering to vote. And that's kind of one of the great goofy kind of scenes. And I thought, I guess I'm stuck with this country. So I am. Today is the sort of day that, you know, has a sort of book title like A Series of Unfortunate Events. Like that. Or the koan that goes, the governor asks, some sort of kind of official asks the Zen teacher. It says in the sutra that adverse winds blew the ship off course and drove it towards the land of the demons. What does that mean? And the governor said, "Oh, I don't know." And the teacher said, "I don't know. You know, you wouldn't get it. You're just a governor." And the governor said, "No, I'm serious." He said, "Yeah, but you know, you're not very bright. You know, you're not just a governor. Kind of, you're too stupid." And the governor starts to get incredibly enraged. And the teacher says, "Adverse winds blew the ship off course and drove it toward the land of the demons." So the land of the demons can hijack. You may not be interested in the land of the demons, but the land of the demons may be interested in you. And so My thought, I have a couple of thoughts of how to walk through unpredictable, uncertain, and I think you can reasonably say difficult times. And so I'll share them with you. I'm sure they'll help. And so I suppose that's the first thing is we do not control what appears in front of us. We do not control the thoughts that appear, the emotions that appear. They are, they are the flashes of lightning and the bubbles on the river, on the stream that appear. We do not control them, and we can argue with them or fight with them, but nonetheless, that doesn't seem to help. So, in other words, reality has its own views of things, you know. And we don't actually even need a view of reality. I suppose it's said that way. And then the next thing to say would be, it's not a bad time to wake up. If you're just considering getting enlightened, this might be a good time. Try it, you might like it. It's like, what else are you going to do, you know? I didn't know, but I corresponded with a guy on death row who actually had a big enlightenment experience and found death row extremely helpful for getting enlightened. So there's that. And they killed him, but he got enlightened. So the life he had was good. Such as it was. So there's, and you know, in the end, we all die, so it's what are we going to do with this? What are we going to do with what we got? And what we got is vast, and every moment what we have is vast. And there's a magnificence to just breathing the air, tasting the light, hearing the sound of the rain, looking in somebody's eyes. And that's cannot ever be taken away. You have that. And as long as you're alive, you have that. And when you're not alive, we can worry about that then, afterwards. So we have that. So that's the next thing. So the waking up thing is good. One thing that waking up means a couple of things, I think, in getting enlightened, whatever we call it. Can you hear me in the back? Can you hear me soon? The waking up means a couple of things. You know, it's got a couple of implications. And I suppose one of them would be a kind of simplicity about things. you notice that your mind fabricates universes before it consults you about it. You know, like you have feelings, opinions, person next to you at the stoplight looks threatening or wonderful, or you'd like to date them, or whatever it is. And your mind just did that. You don't actually have any personal interest in any of these things. Right, so that happens. There's or your mind's comparing them, or making comments, you know. And so your mind makes worlds, and that's not really a problem yet, but living in them becomes a problem. You know, so the simplicity is don't bother living in the world your mind makes. And you can say, okay, but I'll stop living in the world my mind makes when my mind stops making those worlds, but you know, that's like saying, I will get enlightened after you stop behaving the way you do. when you listen to me better and mirror my feelings. So there's that. So getting enlightened has a kind of not adding things and also not sort of falsely subtracting either. You know, so addition and subtraction. This is a very old meditation instructions I'm giving you, actually, you know. Don't add shit and don't take shit away. But if delusion has appeared, you don't have to fight it. That would be the subtraction thing. Surangama Sutra says, don't raise delusive thoughts. All right? Hang on. But when delusive thoughts have arisen, don't suppress delusive thoughts. So in other words, just, you know, you don't have to be in a fight with life all the time. And so if you're feeling, something's going on and you're feeling sad about it, let's say, or frightened or whatever it is, you don't have to add stuff to that. You know, you don't have to say, this is the greatest tragedy since Genghis Khan. We don't know whether it's the greatest. Maybe it's only the greatest tragedy since Napoleon. We don't really know. Maybe it's not even a tragedy. We don't know that. And you don't have to say, you don't have to say, I feel fine about this when you don't, either. So there's that, right? So reality is a kind of beautiful thing for a meditator. Part of simplicity is not to sort of, I suppose, indulge in hell. Like, any time we think that we're not enough, or you're not enough, or that we're in a little piece of pain and anguish, right? Anytime we think it's not possible because of something you're doing or something or some quality I have, anytime we're attacking us and diminishing each other and ourselves like that, it's a kind of hell. And we think, well, I can get away with a little bit of it because it's kind of fun. But you notice that a little bit of hell is hell. And so, but you also notice that a little bit of joy is all the vastness of the singing in the galaxies. You know? So, you see a raindrop falling off a leaf. All right. It's got something to be said for it. You know? And so to, in a certain sense, there's a kind of integrity that we can have about our joy and our sorrow. And if you have sorrow, and then you'll notice that even sorrow is not outside the quality of joy. You'll notice that sorrow has its own light. Even despair has its own light, although the, you know, a lot of like bass drums and drama going on with it, but it's got its own light. And so everything we have has its own light. It's not just, happiness is not just about being happy in a simple sense, it's about embracing life, or letting life embrace us. And then you notice that probably you spend less time in sorrow and despair and things. But you know, that's okay. They'll come back when you need them. So there's that. And then, let me... one part of the don't add things is that we don't need a correct version of who we are. The whole theme of this week has been something like that. Like, as soon as I have a version of who I am, my life starts to sort of diminish a bit, right? You know? And I'm someone whose cell phone is vibrating in his pocket. Is this true? And yeah, so we don't need to know who we are, because all the knowing who I am does diminish me. You know, a lot of it's made of what I can't do or what I should do. And really, that's kind of not it, is it? You know, we know that that's a diminishment. It's a kind of prison. So we don't need explanations. And there's another sutra that says, if I can quote this correctly, because it's kind of funny. This is a... It's along the lines of the simplicity, but Vimalakirti asked Manjushri, what are the Dharma gates through which bodhisattvas enter non-duality? Very important. Manjushri said, my idea is this. In all phenomena, there is no word, there are no explanations, no instructions, no consciousness. Leaving behind all questions and answers is the way you enter the Dharma gate of non-duality. Funny thing is that he's explaining and instructing them. And then Manjushri said, we have all spoken for ourselves. It's your turn to speak now, sir, to Vimalakirti. How do the bodhisattvas enter the Dharma gates of non-duality? And the sutra says, Vimalakirti was silent. But his explanation. So one of the questions here, the question in this is here is that how do you get, if you're in prison, how do you get out of prison? You know, if you've been blown to the land of the demons, how do you get, the demons in this that particular koan were the demons who eat human beings, so there was an incentive to get out of the land of the demons. And the problem is, like, when you're free, one thing you might notice, if you ask, who am I, and the spaciousness opens, there's no end to the spaciousness, you know. And you might even get, the end might be you become anxious because it feels unfamiliar or something like that, you know. There's no end to the vastness of life, galaxy upon galaxy, you know. And in each part, you know, in the net of Indra, each universe, you know, a drop of the water dripping off the trees tonight has a universe. And each universe exists, thousands of universes, or millions of infinite universes exist in the same space without interfering with each other. Fair enough. So it's like that. So the vastness is there, but then something appears, and you can explain that however you want. You can say karma, or I got scared, or I don't know, I got bored with infinity, and I decided that it's more fun to be in despair, you know, something like that. But something happens, and then you're in prison, and when you're in prison, you notice you cannot imagine. All you can see is walls. And you can't find doorways. So that's that situation of confinement that you'll often, you know, people usually complain about, right? I was meditating along and now I'm really stuck and I'm bored and I hate it. It's tedious and plus it sucks, you know. And we notice that that's a kind of resistance happening, that we're in a prison. And so when you're in the prison, by definition, you don't know how to get out of prison, because if you did, you'd be out, right? And there are different ways to get out, but I would say that the thought that you don't know how to get out of prison is itself part of the prison. That's not true. And it's like, you know how when you're sleeping, at some stage, if you do enough meditation, you realize when you're sleeping, you're meditating. You can be meditating. I don't know if you noticed that, but probably in sesshin you might notice that. And you might notice that, well, why not? You know, strange things can happen in sleep. You know, and so strange, and sleep is like, strange things can happen in prison. Light can get in, locks can fall off, things like that. You know, when my kid was little, she liked me to tell her a story, and then from there the demands escalated. And for whatever reason, and so she liked, when she was really little, she liked me to hold her while she fell asleep, and I was kind of tired, and I would be tired, and I'd have told her a story, which was sort of exhilarating and frightening at the same time, because I had to make it up every night, or every second night, every second night. But I'd fall asleep, and she wanted me to be with her, and she'd fall asleep, but you know, she wouldn't fall asleep unless I fell asleep. And I could sort of fall asleep, and so it was really interesting. It was like, we were like two divers going down, and we'd go down, 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 down together. And at some stage, I had to sort of just, and then go up, up, but I couldn't do it unless we were really asleep. Because if I went down halfway, you're not leaving, are you? So it was kind of fun in a way. And if I didn't, if I stayed asleep, of course, then I woke up on top of the bed at 2 a.m. freezing. And that wasn't good, so. So that's just to say that, you know, we can do a lot of things that we don't know we can do. And one of the main things we can do, that little story about sleep isn't important, except that most of our lives are a kind of sleep, and we can wake up. And we know how to wake. Just say, we know how to get out of prison, we know how to wake up. We do have that knowledge. It's not weird, really. And when we stop being scared of waking up, we realize it's much closer to us than we thought. So there's that. And then the waking up, part of the simplicity of waking up is realizing that it's all right to live in a world that we did not fabricate. That's a profound thing. For me, that was a profound thing because, you know, I don't know, I suppose I thought I was responsible for everything. And, not quite, but, you know, it's like, the world is the world, and we hear, and we make up all these the explanations, stories, like the Vimalakirti thing said, but they're not yet world. There are our explanations about the world are part of the world, but they're not much use to us. Although they can be fun, you know. And, or terrifying. And it depends what you want to be. You know, some people like that whole Halloween ride, you know, the terrifying one. You know, they lobby for that, you know. So there's that capacity we have. And then the other thing to say would be that just the way you secretly know how to wake up, you might notice that secretly you're always very close to meditation. You're never very far from it. In fact, we might say that meditation is the thing that's most interesting to you because it's the condition in which everything else occurs. And anything that occurs outside of meditation in some sense, you know, isn't. In some sense it feels like delusion, it feels thick or complex or something like that. And so after a while you realize, oh, meditation, yeah, that's what's happening, isn't it? Yeah. And it's really different from the model that, you know, probably people start with, which is, oh God, meditation, I've got it's good for me, I'll sit down and force myself to do it, you know? And then I'll set a timer so I don't look at my watch, you know? But in a way, and that's fine, but meditation, that's not yet meditation, you know? It's a noble diligence of discipline, but it's not meditation. And so to meditate is to rest in the universe that we did not construct. Yeah. So, and it's always here. And then you'll notice that meditation is not really that hard because you can't help doing it. You know, you wake up in the middle of the night and, oh, it's right there. And if you feel like you don't like your consciousness when you wake up in the middle of the night, you can get up and formally meditate if you like. But as I said, there's a kind of light that we always have with us, which Lin Ji was always saying, you know, but it's an old, old teaching. It's much older than, it's part of the Koan universe, but it's an old, old teaching that the light is with us, and it's not with us, you know. So in some sense, we're resting in that all the time, and then, I don't know, whatever happens, we start explaining the world, or we get lonely for something, and we get in pain, and we think that's bad, and we start fighting with it, and we feel boats drifting off to the land of the demons again, and that's what. And then, then the simplicity, not adding things, the simplicity says, don't disapprove of that. Yeah, don't approve of that. Don't get recruited by the demons, but don't disapprove of, you know, drifting off course, because that's taking you further off course. And if you stop disapproving of what your mind is doing, suddenly you're free again, and you're not in prison again. So it doesn't matter how deeply your mind is in prison, if you stop disapproving of it, if you stop thinking, God, I hope I never have this meditation state again, or I hope this never happens again, or, oh my God, I know I can't bear this. We know that's kind of horseshit, you know. And so if we stop thinking that, we don't have to bear it, we don't have to face it, we don't have to grit our teeth, we just have to not disapprove of it. so there's that. And and sometimes that's pretty intense, you know. I think it was like some I remember once going into an emergency room in really considerable pain. They asked me, and it was a very gritty. It was in the process of being pulled down, and it was, which is kind of interesting in itself. There were like plywood panels up for some of the walls and things, and there was a nurse who'd come in and scream people's names, like a sergeant major or something, and she'd scream, "Tarrant!" And she said, "Number four." So it was great, and she was your She was the kind goblin introducing you to the emergency room. And they said, but the first thing they asked me was, "Well, on a scale of 1 to 10, what's your pain?" And I thought, well, you know, there's that woman who did this great pain scale of like one of them was, "I'm actively being eaten by a bear." That was, that was 9. I can't remember what 10 was. But anyway, so. And I thought, oh, I guess I'm not actively being eaten by a bear. I'm just like in agony. So I'd probably about 3. And so they never called me till dawn. You know, and I sat there all night in pain. It was really funny. But people came through with gunshot wounds and things. So it's very hard to tell what, you know, if you even if you're actively being eaten by a bear, you know, you can use that chance to wake up. It's like, it's what it is, right? The bear doesn't have any malign. It doesn't matter what the bear's intention is, you know. Right. What matters is, are you awake? You know? And then there's that, you know. Then I suppose, so in that sense, meditation, you know, we have all these stories about meditation, how that it can be hard, but that's just explanations, right? And as Vimalakirti says, you know what he says about explanations? Nothing. So it's like, okay, fair enough. That's how he explains it. And in a certain sense, we know that. You know, so it's kind of delicious when he says nothing. How would you explain it? He says nothing. You think, that's a great explanation. He's onto something there. And so then in a certain sense, I remember... in my very early retreats, I had a very, you know, partly the retreats with, you know, everyone get hit with the encouraging stick, or the painful stick, according to the tradition you come from, and there'd be like 2 sticks going up and down the rows, and people yelling and stuff, and to encourage you, and. I didn't know. I didn't really know whether I found that encouraging, actually. but the idea was that you need to break through and you need to really struggle to break through. Fair enough. Okay. So I had that idea, but what would happen for me is I didn't really pay too much attention to the stick thing. But my legs hurt a lot, and it took me years to realize it was my mind that hurt. You know, but my legs hurt a lot, and so I would get through. I would do these pain meditations where I'd go into the pain and I'd think, I will punch out the wall after the next walking meditation. That's how I'd get myself through a whole day in the second day of session or something. And I knew it was kind of a dodge, but that was how I did it. And then at some stage I realized, oh, I'm just fighting myself, that I'm not actually in pain. There's no, you know, session is not hard. It just, you know, my mind constructs things. My mind fabricates reality, which this is a hard thing. So after that, I relaxed a lot, you know. And eventually, you know, we don't, as you notice, we don't hit you very much. You know? And so because it seemed like, oh, it's just adding stuff, you know. So I would say that it, you know, if you're in this world where meditation is easy, you can't help doing it. In fact, you're doing it right now. Just look. Just notice. Yeah? If you look inside right now, you'll find the light is not there. Right? Let's say. Because it can't not be there. You know, because it's part of you, being you, your being. And then you actually, when you're in prison, secretly, part of the despair of prison is we know that we put ourselves there, you know, and we know that we know the way out, in a way, and we forgot, or we're pretending we don't know, or something like that. You know. And so, yeah. So there's that. And meditation gradually gets us to be able to navigate, like, and it is good to meditate more. I found it good to meditate more. I like to meditate because, in a formal kind of way, we actually sit and meditate. Because, why? I don't know, actually. I think because it seems to help us move. We're moving the dark so much. It's like that. We get out of the prison in sleep. So if I fall into prison, if I meditate a lot, it's much easier to get out, and I spend a lot less time, you know, fighting with the jailers or something. Complete distraction. So there's that. And I think so I think and then the other thing is that the other thing that everybody finds, right, in times of difficulty, I mean, the most true thing is, you know, when, you know, disaster hits, what do we do? The old teacher was asked, and he said, welcome. And welcome. And this was a person living during times of civil war with bandits actively, bears actively trying to eat his temple. So it's not like, no. He actually lived a long time. He got away with it. He lived up to be 120, so. You never know. You never know where you'll be safe, you know? So, and you never know if you flee to somewhere where, you know, the great Australian story about the gentleman who foresaw that Australia was going to be bombed by the Japanese and went to a safe Pacific place called Guadalcanal to wake up the war. That nobody would ever have any interest in. So we can't, you know, it's very hard really to be safe in this life because this life is not fundamentally about safety. Yeah. And so that was part of the deal when we came in. It's like we're always stepping into the vastness, and then that's in a way safe. That's what's safe. And it's going to be your friend, but you can't use it to avoid the thusness of things. You know? So the simplicity is like it's not a gadget. You can't use the meditation of its discoveries as a gadget. We still have to, you know, sit through the emergency room all night or whatever it is, or learn how to hack the pain scale or something. I don't know why I didn't sort of go in and say, "Hey, I think I have I've raised my bid." It was sort of interesting seeing that, you know, start to hallucinate and things, but in a way, you know, it was good not to be frightened of that. You know. And then the final thing to say about difficult times, the welcome is in a way that, you know, category of, clearly that's correct, and clearly it's also in the category of nice work if you can get it. So I think that we won't always feel that way. And also, you know, there's a great tradition of, you know, try to influence, try, you know, we try to help the world, we try to influence the world, we try to get people medicine, we try to get people clarity, we try to, you know, help people dodge wars or hide people when they need hiding and things like that. And so, you know, some of you are probably going to be involved in very active work in the world in the times to come, in a way that you hadn't thought you would be, making trouble of some kind. And so then it's nice to have the thing I've found, and the thing I think everybody thinks who has any wisdom, is it's good to have the places of refuge where we can come, and so that we don't get too crazed by the delusion that we're working with, you know. Because if you're working in politics, you're working in the middle of delusion and madness, right? And you have to enjoy that, you know. Plus corruption and sadism, and, you know. And so, in a way, there's got to be a way to be at peace with that, otherwise you're being actively eaten by a bear again, you know. And so the peace would be all this stuff about don't add stuff, you know. You know, you end up dealing with people that you didn't wish to deal with, but, you know. Somebody asked Churchill about religion, and he said, well, if the devil offered to help me against Mr. Hitler, I would ask him how many legions he had. I would not say no. So there's that thing about, you know, when you're working in the world, it's never simple, it's always complex and strange, but so you need peace in your heart in some way, or a place to go to refresh yourself, so that, and here would be the final thing to say, that you notice that the first part of getting into prison is everything gets literal, your imagination disappears, and beauty disappears. And so beauty becomes a subversive, and loyalty to beauty, and loyalty to generosity and kindness that become, you know, they're on the side of the simplicity, they're on the side of the light, and so there's that. And to link right back to the beginning of this talk, it just never does hurt to get enlightened.